Hey, Dr. C here with you. So let's talk about Epstein Barr virus. This is a topic that I've had a lot of questions about, and many have expected that this is the one thing holding them back. They've taken herbs, they've changed their diet, they've tried hard to eradicate the Epstein Barr in hopes that that's the key to really helping their thyroid get better. And let's make sense out of this. We'll talk about what we know from the science and what the popular views are and get some good conclusions. Here's a quick preview. In most cases, there are errors in how Epstein-Barr labs are read. Most people have had exposure to Epstein-Barr, and the labs show that, but that's not the same as having active Epstein-Barr. So big difference there, and we'll talk about that. So first off, what is this thing? You know, what does it do? Where does it come from? You know, what is it? So Epstein-Barr is what's called a herpes family virus. And the word herpes, we immediately think about like genital herpes or cold sores, and they are in that family. Those are HHV, human herpes virus, type 1, type 2, generally. So yeah, those are some well-known members, but there's a lot of things in the family that cause human infections and many that don't. So cytomegalovirus, Epstein-Barr virus, varicella zoster virus behind chickenpox, HHV6, these are all herpes class viruses. So who gets Epstein-Barr and how do they get it? Well, who gets it is pretty much everyone. We think that by adulthood, 95% or more of the population has had Epstein-Barr. And for almost all people, it's not really significant. It's something that happened early in life and it was not distinct from any random cold or flu. In many cases, there were no symptoms at all. There are those who are exposed in their teens for one of the first times, and perhaps with a larger viral load when they are exposed. And in those cases, they get what was known as infectious mononucleosis. So there are immune cell subtypes called monocytes. And with Epstein-Barr infection, especially that acute stage, there can be a high number of monocytes. So before we knew that Epstein-Barr was a culprit, all we knew is there was a lot of monocytes and they were sick. So we called it monocytosis, or, you know, mono for short. And in those cases, someone could be just wiped out, just like totally exhausted, fevers, miserable, swollen glands. They could last 2-3 weeks, you know, and then generally they would recover. So that's infectious mononucleosis. Now, we know that viruses, in many cases, are not our friends. You know, there are low-grade stressors they can put on our bodies that can affect us in ways long-term. We know that those who have active Epstein-Barr or who've had acute infections in the past have greater risks for lymphomas. We know that that's true, especially when the virus itself is not completely suppressed. So generally, we have it early in life. It's inconsequential. We suppress it to where the amount of it in our body is negligible. Not none, but negligible. And then it's pretty much along for the ride. So that's what's known about it in general. Now, people can be tested for Epstein-Barr. And I'm actually bringing this topic up rather early along in the discussion on purpose, because this is a really important point. So there's an image I want to talk to you about. And this shows how blood levels for Epstein-Barr virus change over various time frames. So when you're first exposed, so if a teenager gets mono or if a young person is first exposed to Epstein-Barr, that's the primary infection. In the first few weeks, they'll have IgM antibodies elevate. These are called BCA IgM antibodies. And they may not be there immediately. They may take a week or a couple weeks to show up, maybe even a month. But they generally go down and stay low longer term. They don't always. There are cases where IgM antibodies do stay positive long after the primary infection. The BCA Ig antibodies, those come up pretty early in the process as well. However, they stay high long term. And this is how we know that most people have had it, because most people have positive BCA Ig antibodies. And the level of which they're high doesn't really change things. Some people have really high IgG antibodies, some have lower, but those don't mean that it's still active. And then we have the EBNA, the Epstein-Barr nuclear antigen marker, and that generally takes several months to show up, but once that shows up, that also stays there long-term. So most people that have had Epstein-Barr in the past will have positive IgG antibodies, a positive EBENA. In some cases, some rare cases, the early antigen and the IgM may remain positive. That's not typical. So convalescent serology just means that the acute phase has passed. You had it some point before. There's another test, which is called the PCR, the Epstein-Barr PCR DNA. And what that's looking at is the actual DNA of the virus. And this is a DNA-based virus. Now, this one gives a more direct reflection of the number of active viruses in the bloodstream at a given point. So it's not always helpful for the acute infection, and it's a test that's not as commonly available and less cost-effective, and it may take a little longer to turn positive at first. But it's the best test when we're thinking about a chronic infection, about someone who was infected a long time ago and it's remaining in their bodies. That's how we know it's still there if it's chronic, because they've got a positive PCR. So we'll talk more about that. But my experience is that almost all people who have been told they have Epstein-Barr, it's based upon a faulty reading of the tests. So now moving forward. So what do we know about Epstein-Barr and thyroid disease? Well, we know there's definitely a relevance with a thing called subacute thyroiditis. So this is in the larger category of thyroid disease. It's not the most common form of thyroid disease, and it's one that's generally self-limiting. This is a kind of thyroid disease that usually comes on after an acute cold or viral infection. It actually can happen after SARS-CoV-2. We know that that can be a trigger of it. But generally, it causes the thyroid to make a lot of hormone for a little bit, slow down for a little bit, and then normalize, usually within about a 2 to 6 week time frame. And not the most common culprit, but Epstein-Barr can be one of the culprits. So we know that it's been associated with that condition. But we also know that those with the condition have a higher rate of Epstein-Barr antibodies. So there's some tie. Now, there's a larger body of data looking at how infections tie to autoimmune disease in general. And we know that those with autoimmune thyroid disease are more frequently apt to have herpes virus DNA. So they're more apt to have the actual genes that are relevant to the virus. We also know that Graves' disease is more common to be present in those who have had severe mononucleosis. We see that Graves' antibodies relate to the infection of Epstein-Barr early along in life. And there's a few other models by which we know that there can be some possible links. So from the data, what's thought about in science is that Epstein-Barr is not the only agent, not the sole factor to drive thyroid disease, but it may be a contributor. Now, what we don't know is whether it's relevant for causing the disease and perpetuating the disease. So that's different. The classic aphorism is the horse is already out of the barn. And the story is that once the horse is out of the barn, you probably can't catch it and put it back in if it's a wild horse. It's too late. The problem has already gone past the immediate solution. You know, closing the barn door won't put the horse back in. So the related question is, even if Epstein-Barr were a contributor to causing thyroid disease, would treating Epstein-Barr then help thyroid disease that emerged? And there's really no data suggesting it does. So we think a lot about correlation and causation. If two things go together, you know, does one cause the other? It may be that they just show up by coincidence. It could be that one causes the other. It could be that the other causes the one. And it could also be that a third factor causes both. And there's some speculation about that now with Epstein-Barr and autoimmune disease. So the thought is whether Epstein-Barr virus causes autoimmune disease or whether autoimmune disease causes Epstein-Barr. So that sounds kind of weird. Let me unpack that a little bit. So it wouldn't be fair to say that autoimmune disease causes Epstein-Barr. But remember now, most everyone has had exposure to Epstein-Barr. But some people don't really suppress it as completely as others. So autoimmune disease is an error in which your immune system attacks something that it should not attack. It attacks some part of your body's own tissues. And what we're seeing is that in these situations, the body may also fail to attack something that it should. So it's possible that the same thing that would make you prone to attack your thyroid could make you prone to not attack a chronic infection like Epstein-Barr virus. So it's possible that some underlying susceptibility could could cause someone to have higher amounts of Epstein-Barr virus in their body, higher antibody levels, greater chance of it being latent and still perhaps affecting their health in some way. But the underlying immune issue could be behind both. So this is a serious question. And we know that those with autoimmune disease may have more circulating antibodies for Epstein-Barr, but it may not be that Epstein-Barr causes that. It may be that the same glitch that causes people to attack one thing by mistake could make them not attack something else by mistake. So that's a serious question. So why did the idea of Epstein-Barr become thought to be such a big driver of thyroid disease? Well, it's been talked about for some time, Epstein-Barr, as being a culprit to kind of nebulous health issues. You know, chronic fatigue syndrome was thought to be driven by Epstein-Barr at one point. So it's always been there as a bit of a bugaboo. And there have been many who have read the labs and misinterpreted them. And if you do that, you would do that a lot because most everyone has positive IgG Epstein-Barr antibodies. So if you didn't understand that distinction, one could easily think, oh, wow, this is an epidemic. This is affecting a lot of people. And a doctor could have patients that have unexplained stubborn symptoms and test them and say, hey, wow, they've got these high Epstein-Barr antibodies. And the last patient that I saw with these symptoms, they had those antibodies as well. And the problem is, well, everyone does, you know? So it's not that it's unique to that population, but nonetheless, so it's been this latent background idea. But there was a book that took the idea and really just ran to the hills with it. And the book basically said as a quote that the Epstein-Barr drills into the thyroid and attacks the gland's tissue, scarring it and impeding its function and making the thyroid not work. The book also went on to say that the solution to thyroid disease is to avoid foods that drive Epstein-Barr and to eat foods and nutrients that kill Epstein-Barr. So the assumptions are that the virus actually harms the thyroid and that its presence is needed to perpetuate thyroid disease, and that the virus depends upon certain foods. And somehow, even though we eat foods and break them down into their parts, somehow the food themselves, when we eat them, yeah, I don't know, I'm having a hard time with it. The source also claimed that Epstein-Barr is the sole cause of lupus, chronic fatigue syndrome, fibromyalgia, tinnitus, you know, ear ringing, vertigo, Meniere's disease, insomnia, asthma, mitral valve disease, esophageal spasms, and a whole lot more. So it's basically saying it's the sole cause of all these conditions and the sole cause of thyroid disease. And if you eat certain things or take certain herbs, you can kill it and reverse thyroid disease. Now, it'd be awesome if it were that simple. I mean, that would be a cool thing if we had one simple explanation. So where does this data come from? Well, here's where I struggle. So the reference behind this work is Spirit. To quote, this data comes from Spirit, the person says. And a little more detail, he means ghosts. So he speaks to ghosts, and ghosts tell him these things. I'm having a hard time keeping a straight face, truth be told. I don't consider ghosts a valid reference. Yesterday, my family and I were showing our house. We're putting a house for sale, and we had to be out of it for a little while. So we're driving to, we had to take our dog with, you know, so we went to drive to a park just to have our supper. I made food we brought with, have a little picnic and be out of the way. And we weren't sure, we had to drop some things off before then. And we weren't sure where was a nice park nearby. So we looked at Google Maps and looked at some pictures of parks, but we didn't ask ghosts. I didn't ask Casper the friendly ghost, but I didn't close my eyes and say, Casper, please direct me to a good park nearby. We don't do that. We don't think about ghosts as valid sources of information in the modern world. So it almost makes my head explode that an idea that's taken on so much presence and has gone so viral, ha, pun intended, that it came from a ghost. That's just not part of the modern world. So anyway, that's where the big idea came from. And again, it was an idea that had some fertile ground. Epstein-Barr has been thought about being a possible issue for some time. So what do we know about treating Epstein-Barr and if it would help thyroid disease or not? Well, the data is pretty strong that if we have the infection, whatever it does to the immune system, it persists and it doesn't really do more things after we already have it. Those issues then go on. And bad things about Epstein-Barr, so it can get reactivated. There are cases in which Epstein-Barr can become severe. And after you've had it in the past, it can become active again and shut down the immune system. Now, in those cases, they're almost always secondary to immunosuppression. That means someone who has a very poor immune function, and I mean very poor, like almost nil, that's generally due to genetic variations, immunosuppressant medications, such as used in organ donation or in immunosuppression for cancer treatments. Those are cases where this happens. And it looks just like mono. They'll have the same acute findings they have in mono, swollen glands, pretty high fevers, you know, things that are significant. Now, there's also a thing called chronic active Epstein-Barr virus. So this is something that, where I talked about the PCR tests help show that up. And this is a big deal. This is something that also just shows up in immunosuppressed populations, but it's Epstein-Barr coming back, and it's nearly fatal. It's fatal more often than not. So this is a case where someone does get it. They're not conscious. It's infecting their whole bodies, and they generally die from that over short periods of time. But this doesn't happen to people who are not just blatantly immunosuppressed in one way or another. So putting all this together, what do you do? When did you think about Epstein-Barr? When did you think about treating it? Well, if you've had some significant unexplained viral symptoms, let's say you've got a fever, no reason for that. You've got a sore throat, got some swollen, painful lymph nodes. Maybe your spleen, your liver are swollen. You've got a rash. So those are some classic symptoms for acute Epstein-Barr virus. Now, let's say that your labs show that your IgM is up. This is all pretty suspicious. If you've had it in the past and you're an adult by this point, then it's worth doing a PCR test. If that's positive, this is acute Epstein-Barr virus. It's no joke. This is a big deal. It requires significant medical care. And in those cases, if it's actually the chronic active form, there's not a lot for treatment. There's inpatient care, there's stem cell transplantation that's talked about. So however, though, if you've got these patterns and your PCR is negative, could it still be Epstein-Barr? Well, very rarely, and that would be with a positive IgM, that would be with some painful swollen lymph nodes, elevated lymphocyte count in a blood count, high white count. And in those cases, we think about antiviral treatments. A lot of that is rest. Intravenous vitamin C can be useful. There's some good clinical data behind that. Fluids, general immune support. Actually, kind of a curious thing, but spironolactone, an older diuretic medication, also may have some antiviral properties in those contexts. So big picture, if you're sick, if you have an acute viral infection, it is one thing to think about among several. If you're kind of not well, if you're sore, achy, tired, struggling with your thyroid, those aren't really things making one think it would be Epstein-Barr. And if you had Epstein-Barr tests and your IgG markers were positive, welcome to the club. Most of us do. Sadly, many are led to think that means they have a unique problem, and they just don't. I think that doctors are well-intended. They don't understand how to read those, but those are just normal signs of past exposure. So, all right, that's it. Dr. C here with you, and that was a big story on Epstein-Barr. Hope that was helpful. Take great care.